Now, let me talk to you about the added benefit that I really wish we could spend more time on, because this really is the exciting part of rail as far as I'm concerned. It's a concept called transit-oriented development. Now, those of you that lived on the mainland and other parts of the world, you have seen the tremendous quality of life benefits that result when you have a train station that is built appropriately, bringing in people as a critical mass to ride the train, live near the train station, work near the train station, and the benefits that have come as a result of that. Next time you go to Washington, D.C., if you haven't, go to Alexandria, Virginia, and look on King Street. Now, those of you that are familiar with Virginia, and we happen to have a home in Falls Church, so we kind of get back every now and then. But in Alexandria, Virginia, King Street, if you remember what it was like or recall, or ask some of the folks there, tell you what it was like 10, 12, 15 years ago. It was run down. It was dilapidated. Go there now. Four major hotels. The U.S. Patent Office has relocated there because of rail. And that includes 7,000 federal employees who are working in and around that area. Condominiums, office complexes, and schools. So this has really brought about quality growth in an area that was basically run down, depressed, that stood reaped the better benefits that has resulted as a result of rail. So through our Department of Planning and Permitting, we've already been aggressively working with communities such as Waipahu, such as Kapolei, Aiea, Procity, and we'll be moving this along the rail route to do a community-based planning process. We've hired a specialist, a gentleman by the name of Terrence Ware, who was an expert in how TOD was done in Denver. So we've had Terrence come here. He's working here full time, working with DPP, collaborative with our rail transit division to get people's ideas on how they'd like to see their communities emerge as a result of transit. And to me, this is going to be the real exciting part of this whole aspect here. Additional monies will come in. Private sector investment. DC has seen an estimated $15 billion has been invested into that community as a result of transit-oriented development. And we believe we'll see the kind of interest, and at the end of the day, private sector dollars that will make this happen. And here's another interesting development. Secretary LaHood recently announced that the criteria for funding for rail projects will now take on the aura and criteria of livable communities. They want to know what you're doing to be green. They want you to know what you're doing to be sustainable. And that's going to be a collaborative effort with Department of Transportation, the EPA, and the Housing Urban Development Department. So all of them coming together. And this is welcome news for us because we really believe this will enhance the attractiveness and the appeal of our project going forward, because we believe we have a wonderful story to tell about TOD in these communities here. So what we're doing at the city already, we've got our agencies and our departments working together. We're working hard to develop a strategy to pursue federal grants, and also here locally, what we can do. We have a clean water fund, as many of you know, at the city level, and I've already been in discussions with Council Chair Todd Apo, and how we can make those funds available for TOD. Because we really believe at the end of the day, it's not just about riding the train, it's about enhancing your quality of life. It's about reducing the commute time. It's about making sure that you can live, recreate, and play around the area that the train is coming through. So we're very optimistic about that. No wonder James Oberstar, the U.S. House Transportation Infrastructure Chair, has called this not only the most exciting transit project in America, but just 2 weeks ago he told me in his office, this is the number one transit project in America. And that's significant, because that's not coming from a Hawaii congressman or a Hawaii senator. That's coming from a Minnesota congressman who happens to be the number one person on the House side when it comes to funding for transportation infrastructure. Next slide. Okay. We were very happy. I can't tell you, that was one of my best days being the mayor of Honolulu, when Administrator Peter Rogoff did a press conference with the press throughout America, when they announced funding that the Obama administration was putting into their budget for transit projects throughout America. We were number one for getting the largest amount for what they call New Starts funding. Okay, we got $55 million that came from the Obama administration. Now, this is significant because all of the funding we have received so far for over a three-year period that amounts to about $65 million has been initiated by the Congress, okay, largely driven through Senator Inouye and our congressional delegation with a lot of support, obviously, to move that, those initiatives forward. But this was a statement from the Obama administration that this project is indeed worthy, not just of funding, but of substantial federal funding. But I want to talk a little bit about his comments, because it should go a long way towards dispelling some of the innuendos and statements that have been made with respect to our rail transit project being shaky. First of all, he said there is some considerable strength to this project. Okay? Those are words right from Peter Rogoff himself. Now, why is he saying this? It's because thanks to the legislature in approving legislation to raise the general excise tax, we have a local funding mechanism in place where we are putting our money where our mouth is and actually collecting our share to put forward on this project here. As of December 2009, we have collected $460 million. So this is why he said there is some considerable strength to this project. And most importantly, also said that the money that we have set aside for this is a project that other entities or cities would just dream of having at this stage. Okay, we're actually doing it. We're collecting it, and it can be used for no other purpose but for rail. We substantiated that because it had to go to the Honolulu City Council to pass legislation to also approve the GET, and as the mayor, I had to approve that also. So two entities had to agree, but it all started right here in this big square building with the state legislature doing a bold and audacious step. The first time they have raised the general excise tax in over 40 years, and we did it in one legislative session. It happened. Now, why is that so? I believe because of the many failed attempts in the past. This is why it came together so quickly, and because people recognize now more than ever, we need to provide a solution for the ongoing traffic congestion that we face, especially from folks who live on the west side, commuting into town, that would ultimately also benefit all of Oahu once we get it started. He also said, very interesting, our expectation is that the final contribution will be $1.55 billion. So he recognizes that the final EIS has not been released yet. He recognizes that we don't have a record of decision yet. He recognizes that we're not at the final design stage and what have you, and we're not actually breaking ground. But to make this leap of faith, if you will, that Honolulu has a viable project, that we're willing to commit at this time to sign what is called a full funding grant agreement in 2011, speaks volumes of the viability of this project. And last, very important, we would not have included funding in the president's budget for this project if we thought it was falling off the rails. Okay? Very significant. I can't tell you how many phone calls that I've received from my mayoral colleagues around the country, all of whom are just out there selling their projects, trying to do their best to woo federal support and for us to have this kind of commitment from the federal government. One of them even, Joe, what did you do? You gave them a lifetime supply of macadamia nuts. What happened here? I mean, this is just incredible. Some who have been in the transit business for a long time said they've never seen this kind of a statement on behalf of a city that hasn't even started to break ground, or more importantly, the EIS, the final EIS hasn't even been accepted, that a statement like this and a commitment would be made in this regard.